Without further ado, so hi, welcome everyone. So my name is Hua Han. I'm the moderator of the Let's Chat India. I'm so excited to see everyone in here. So without further ado, let's start this session. So at the end of this session, right, we hope that you can gain something insight on this experience of volunteering in India, as well as the impact of the international volunteer to the local impact community of India. Okay, so to ensure that you guys got very good experience in throughout session, so I hope that you can sit in a comfortable place with a good internet and stay relaxed, enjoy the space. So yeah, today we have our two speaker storyteller. The first one will be Jay, who is representative from ISE in India, and Zana, our past exchange participant who went for India before in Global Volunteer. So are you excited? So yeah, first we'll have Jay to sharing the impact of a youth in the local community of India, and Dana to share with you his experience. So after that, we'll be moving on to Q&A session. You guys can feel free to answer any question and interact with our speaker, Jay and Dana. Then we'll be having a short feedback session so that we can improve in next sharing session. And that's it. So without further ado, let's welcome to our first speaker, Jay, to start. So Jay, you can start for your sharing.
Hello. I hope you guys can hear me.
Yep, I can hear.
Sure. Thank you so much. So hello, people. My name is Jay Bhandari, and I'm currently a representative of ISEC in India. I finished my graduation in industrial engineering. I was a student till last year. I finished my graduation in 2019. And since then, I have been working with ISEC as a full-time role. Currently, I am a product head for Global Volunteer in this year of 2019-20. And for the next year, that is starting from August, I'll be the head of finance for ISEC in India for the next 1 year. So that is about me. That has been like a diverse set of experience that I have gone through. And I'm not sure, but probably you might have a question on why I studied engineering and I have changed the field of work that I have been into. But one of the major reasons for that is the kind of experience that I've gone through in ISEC, to be open to multiple scope of areas of work. And that has really helped me to gain more perspective on what I want to do further. So yeah, that's a short introduction from my side. Can we go next? All right, thank you so much. So yes, this is something that I'm going to talk about today. India as a country, I'm here to represent my country. At the same time, if you see at the logo, there's something called... Yeah, if you see at the logo, there's something called India as a feeling, the feeling that makes you smile. So I'll be taking you guys through what this means, or why exactly this logo looks like this in the first place. But before that, there's a video that is coming up that I want you guys to go through. And then we'll continue with what I have to present. Can you please play the video? Can we have the audio as well? Yeah. Thank you.
as hell. Okay, but so are you. Same flight, same row, the same hotel. That sounds fake, but this is the truth. Why don't we just go back, back to where we came from? Summer air, summer air. Why don't we just go back, back to where we came from? Summer air, summer air.
Let's go, let's go. Let's go, let's go. Let's go, let's go. You grabbed my hand, you took me to paradise. If by no chance I forget this night. Since I'm back home, I feel like paralyzed. Baby, it's so wrong. Let's make it right. Why don't we just go back, back to where we came from? Summer air, summer air. Why don't we just go back, back to where we came from? Summer air, summer air. Let's go.
Thank you so much. I hope you guys like the video. So this, just to give a context, this video is from the first experience that I had as a member in ISEC, and all the people who were there in the video were the exchange participants for that particular project that happened in India in the year of 2017. Now, when you see the video, there are a lot of things, there are a lot of different representations from people going on the streets on a two-wheeler, from them experiencing cooking their own food in India. And all of this experience is a part of what exchange in India looks like. But before we even go to that particular conversation, I would want to share a bit more about India in general. Now, starting with religion, I hope you guys would know that India as a country is really, really diverse. There's not one religion that is being followed, or one major religion that has been followed in India. India is a culmination of multiple religions that people follow here, from Hindus to Jains to Buddhists, Sikhs, Islam, Christians. There are a lot of people, a lot of religions that come together, stay in harmony in our country. And that is why we also mention that India is a secular country. We don't really discriminate on what people are or what they really choose to follow as their own religion. And these people coming together create a very diverse environment for someone to go through in the country itself, right? So this is something that makes India really, really unique, because when you move from one place to another, it's not just the same kind of people, but within the country itself, you find different set of people that you would meet, the different way that they live their lives. At the same time, the different things that they do in their day-to-day lives as well. Even the God that they worship varies from what these people are or what these people want to really follow. Can we go next, please? Yes. Second thing is about culture. Second thing is about culture. Now, every religion that is present in India has its own culture. When I say culture, it's not just a term, but culture represents for the kind of belief that they have, the kind of clothes that they wear, the kind of food that they eat. At the same time, the kind of things that they do in terms of festivals. I think you guys would also know about the different kind of festivals that are there in India. One that is Holi, which is a festival of colors, where people celebrate this particular festival by applying color to each other's face and enjoy the diversity in colors that we have. Even the clothes that people are wearing in this particular picture is like a very vibrant, colorful clothes, and that is something that you would find across India. And on the right, there is an image of a design. It's basically something called Rangoli. This is something that people usually make on the in their houses to as a belief that it makes it beautifies the environment in the house itself. And that is the kind of diverse belief that people have in India and what they really hold as a culture. Can we go next, please? Right. At the same time, the food or the cuisine in India also varies a lot. I mean, I would like to say this, that every 100 kilometers that you move in India, that is like one city to another, you will find completely different set of food items that you can really enjoy. At the same time, the completely different food items that you can really taste. Now, on the left, there's something called a thali. It's basically a mixture of 17 to 18 different things coming all together and having that diverse taste in one piece of plate. But on the other side, the food that is being served on a banana leaf. So the green thing is a banana tree leaf. And in the southern part of India, the food is being served on this. And that is how, right from a plate to a banana leaf is how the entire color, the way of serving, and the way how the food looks changes. And even the ingredients change a lot. At the same time, India is a land of spices. So that usually happens, that anyone who comes to India from outside, they sometimes find the food very spicy, but at the same time, they find it really, really tasty. And that is a really special thing that we like to embrace about our country itself. Can we go next, please? Right. Talking about architecture, India has like India is one of the oldest, like a very old country and rich in heritage. It is a home for one of the seven wonders of the world, that is Taj Mahal, which you can see on the left. But at the same time, apart from that, there are multiple heritage sites that are present all over the country. The one on the right is a Hawa Mahal. So this entire structure is made out of multiple windows all over it with an objective to let Hawa means wind. And the idea behind this particular architecture was to ensure that there's enough wind that comes into the palace without any obstruction, and the entire building is, you know, has a really good airflow or air circulation. And that is how varied there are structures and there are architectures in India. At the same time, there are multiple sites which are certified by UNESCO to be a World Heritage Site, right from to the north and to the end. So that is something about architecture that we have in India. Can we go next, please? And that is when all of these coming together is this wonderful set of organization that is ISEC in India that comes together, culmination of all of these cities, that is 31 plus cities, that is a part of this organization, which is playing an active role. And the people of these cities are playing an active role in running this particular organization towards the objective of leadership. We have currently close to 2.2K, that is 2,200 members nationally. At the same time, they deliver close to 3,500 exchanges every single year. And if you see the map, these cities or these locations are spread out towards entire India, right from north, west, east, and south. Can we go next? Something that is really, really special about these locations, and right from, if I had to explain from the first slide, when we say India is a feeling, everything coming together with respect to its culture, with respect to the different religions, the cuisines, the architecture, we believe that every location or every place that ISEC or every city that where ISEC is present has its own different feeling, its own different way of expression for the kind of experience that city holds. Now, if I have to express on what an experience in this city would look like, it would not be the same. I would very strictly say that experience in India as an exchange participant is not same. Each and every location, each and every city has its different kind of experience, and that is defined by the kind of feeling these locations and these cities give to the exchange participant who's coming there. Where you see ISEC in Bangalore, it's a feeling of home. The kind of feeling that ISEC in Bangalore would give to exchange participant is how they express as a feeling of home. Whereas when we go, when we move towards ISEC in Jaipur, it gives the feeling of royalty. The Hawa Mahal, which I showed you in the piece of architecture, that is from the city that is Jaipur, which is the land, which is the pink city of India and the land of lot of palaces. So that is how we really define the diversity of the country, not just in terms of what country has to hold, but even different local chapters or local units of this organization in the country has to hold for you. Can we go next, please? Now, like every other country, even India is not a perfect country. It has its own set of issues, its own set of problems that India has been dealing. So if I had to just give a gist about what kind of problems that we mainly see in our country, is 74% of people, only 74% of the people in India are literate. And this is something I'm talking about, a young population, right? 21 cities out of 30 in the list of world's most polluted cities are coming from India. At the same time, more than 50% of India or more than 50% population of India doesn't have access to clean drinking water. And if I had to go on, the list might continue prevailing with the need of growth that India as a developing country has, right? I mean, the country is growing at this massive pace with respect to its population, its technological advancement, and at the same time, these problems as well prevail with the kind of journey that we are having into the country itself. Can we go next? But something that the country is also moving towards is this, where 50% of the population of the country are covered by young people. Now, when I say young people, I'm talking about people within the age of 30 years, right? The total young people population, or the people from the age of 0 to 30, is more than 600 million. Out of the population of 1.2 billion counting, more than 600 million people are just young people. And at the same time, the average age of a person in India is 29 years, right? And that makes it one of the most youngest country in the entire world. And when we saw these facts, and when as an organization we were looking at what exactly does our country need, or how can exactly we help our country, this particular thing hit our mind that okay, we have a lot of problems for sure, and these problems are not just from one particular field of area, but it's spread between education, accessible green clean water, pollution, etc., and there are varied kind of things that the country is facing. At the same time, country has a really huge young people population. So we ask this question to ourselves, what can we really do? What can we really do to, you know, help this particular problem? And that is when, can we go next? That is when this project that we have comes into picture. Now, if I had to explain this particular project, it's basically, can we go next? This project basically has an objective to spread awareness about SDGs. SDGs are Sustainable Development Goals. These goals are designed by United Nations to cover all the major problems that are prevailing in the entire world, right? And this focuses towards SDG number 4 that encounters the problem of quality education. So the objective of this project, SDG Caravan, is to ensure that all the young people in our country, we are able to reach those young people in order to educate them or make them aware about SDGs, what are the goals that we want to achieve as a country. At the same time, the prevailing local issues and its relation with global issues, to ensure that these people who are in probably their school right now are from now itself empowered to work towards these issues, right? Because when I was in a school, being very honest, I wasn't really aware about what SDGs are. And I really got exposed to these concepts when I came into my university, right? And this is where this idea came budding on, okay, what happens if we spread awareness to a population of 600 million who are most energetic people, most young people, and are still going out to work and to make an impact. So the area of impact of this particular project are the public and private schools and other educational organizations. So this project doesn't really focus towards only one set of people. It focuses on anyone who is right from grade 1 to their university. All of these people inside who are students are an area of impact that we want to focus towards. Ensure that these people who are in their education level, who are still building their thought process, building their mindset, or building their objectives in life, are really empowered to work towards issues. And what we have been able to create as an impact as of now is we have delivered, or we have had more than 100 exchange participants. So this project is not really old. We came up with this project like a few years, 2 years, 3 years back. And we have delivered 100 plus exchange participants just in this project who have spread awareness to more than 2000 young people directly, right? But what is even greater than that is we have been able to engage and empower more than 100,000 people. Now, how is that? Is obviously we could not run a 6 week project for them, but we ensured we had small events during the course of entire project and even post project for them to interact with more and more people from different schools who probably did not host a project with us, but we wanted to give them an experience of how this project would look like if it was in their school or if it was in their classroom. And till now, the project has been able to do an impact to these amount of people, that is 2000 plus people directly and 100,000 young people indirectly empowered as of now. And this project is something that, like, this project is something which is really, really close to me, because when I look at it, there are like multiple young people who are coming into the field of sustainability. Even the people that I work for or I was working with in ISEC before, they have gone out and they are working into the fields of sustainability with different companies and different organizations. And they are really creating impact post the project ends. So if I had to give you an example, in ISEC, I had one person whose name is Sahil. So he was my team leader previously. And when he went out, he was working with Asia Development Bank as in their sustainability wing to work towards how can they engage young people in the projects of Asia Development Bank, and which is like not really small, it's really, really big. When you know, Asia Development Bank is running a project and a person who was empowered with this idea is taking that forward. That is the kind of impact that we have been able to do as of now, and we are looking forward to continue this impact for further years as well. Can we go next? So ISEC in India currently has been moving towards sustainability by working on majorly these 8 SDGs. So we just don't have one project. That was one project which is like, what, you know, one of the projects that we are really, really proud of. At the same time, we are working on SDG 3, which is about good health and well-being, SDG 4, that is quality education, SDG 5, which works towards gender equality. That is also something which is like a prevailing problem in India, where not all genders are treated equally, and we want to work on this particular SDG very, very thoroughly. SDG 8, decent work and economic growth, which is going to be like a very big conversation, at least after this pandemic, because there'll be a lot of people who will be looking for work, and even the skilled people will be looking for work and would want to develop their skills even more to get a better job. Then the SDG 10, which is about reduced inequalities, SDG 13, which is about climate action, something which is all over the world, something which is prevailing all over the world, and SDG 14, life below water, and SDG 15, life on land. These are the 8 SDGs, sustainable development goals, that we are currently been working on. Next. And we have currently hosted around close to 600 plus exchange participants each and every year, just for these kind of projects, which come from countries like, majorly come from countries like Egypt, Turkey, Indonesia, Vietnam, Italy, Brazil, Germany, Bangladesh, and even more. And we even have started, hosting more and more EPs from Malaysia as well in the recent years. And we hope to continue the same for the coming years. Can we go next? And on the closing note, the main thing or the main message that we as ISEC in India want to pass on, that it's not just young people are not just someone who are really low in experience or low in energy. These are the people who are the biggest power of this world. The world's biggest power is the youth. And these are the people who are the best people to carry forward any change that that we want to see in the world. So yeah, that is something that I had to share with you guys. Thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you, Jay, for the sharing and introduce for the Eyes India and also for Running Turing project. So if you guys got any question for Jay, can please don't hesitate, just type out in the chat box. Okay, cool. So we will address them accordingly during Q&A session. So next, we will have Dana to share his experience volunteering in India. So let's welcome Dana.
Hi, thanks, Wahwan. So, oh my God, sorry, it's a technical problem. So let me take my time. Okay, cool. So, all right, so it's me. So I think like you guys, okay, first of all, thank you so much for Wahwan hosting this space and let me share like my experience in India. So first of all, hi, my amazing Malaysian people. So yeah, it's me. And I'm, yeah, I think like you far. I don't know, you know my videos and I keep sharing my videos. I'm sorry if I, me myself, disturbed on your face, right? It was super interesting, by the way. Cool. So it's me again. Cool. So first of all, I would like to introduce myself. So my name is Dana Segun Krishnamurthy. You can just address me, Dana. And I went to India. I went to India in January 2020 and I contributed to SDG number 10. I think like Jay already like, you know, introduce you guys what is SDG 10, and in case you guys like pay attention, do you know like what is SDG 10? Cool. So basically about me myself, like, okay, okay, that's a small picture of me with the red shirt that was taken in India. So basically how to say, my personal information is, yeah, I am from Para, and then I'm still a student. I haven't graduated yet and I'm studying in University Utara Malaysia in Kedah, Sentul Kedah, correction. Cool. So this is basically an introduction about me. So if you want to know me more, you can, you know, ask me questions. Hey Dana, can you give me like your Facebook, or I want to ask you more about India, your experience, blah blah blah, yada yada. Okay, cool. So next, okay, like this is like a super emotional part or whatever, right? So cool. Before like this myself, I go for my experience. This is basically I was, okay, like how I'm a person that I was, like, okay, first of all, not confident, like insecure, and I always think I'm always right, and I'm always quite stubborn, not quite stubborn, I think basically I'm a very stubborn person, impulsive, like taking actions very reactively, very, very impulsive, and I self-blame a lot in terms of things, for the things I can't control, I cannot control. I put my, like, I'm not good enough, I'm not good at this, I'm bad at this, blah blah blah. So I'm always fall into anxious where I start to worry about the things that that's not going to happen, and I'm still like, you know, start worrying about it. So, and I was very, very, very self-esteem person because of my insecurities. So basically this is what I am. This is what I am in terms of before I went to my experience. So this is basically that. I wish you guys can imagine the Dana that I mentioned I was, right? Like, I'm sorry if I'm really like setting expectations with you guys. Sometimes when I exaggerate things, right, some foul language must come out. Forgive me. So you can imagine how I was in, you know, just how bitchy I am or whatever. So this is I was. So basically, I want to like to share a very personal to me, to be honest, a very, very personal thing for me, right? So how I measure the impact for me is through something that has been provided for me, like Isaac provided for me, and something that I put effort for myself. It's how I measure impact in terms of how I turn out to be. Okay, first of all, like this is a very, like, something very emotional and something I connected with, and I found myself in this journey, not to exaggerate things, but the truth is true. Okay, so I want to, like, on the white side, right, this is what I experienced in terms of I haven't introduced my project. So my project is basically is about to be with and to educate, to teach and to be with in terms of nurturing them, the what they call autism kids, and also like disability kids. So I was given a task in terms of handling I was given a task in terms of handling the those. I mean, like, I cannot say those kids because they are part of the community. These kids, the kids were, they were like, you know, autistic, mentally, cognitive disabilities and physical disabilities. To be honest, for you guys, I'm not a very patient person to handle with kids. Okay, I'm still a person that very, very sensitive to kids' energy. Like, I get frustrated a lot. But the experience really taught me that something that's very personally connected with me, which is the kid actually don't see who you are like physically, but they're able to sense in a sense of how do you show care, how do you show love. But I want to like emphasize this, it's not that very easy in terms of getting bond with them or like to be a close friend. It's not easy, okay? 6 weeks is not enough time. Okay, reality check, people. 6 weeks is not enough time if you don't put enough effort. So I was actually thinking, you know, basically I go for the opportunity and then after work, I just feel super famished in terms of, oh my God, my energy was super drained. I started to think, why am I doing this to myself when I cannot handle kids and etc., right? I started to questioning about my journey in India. Why am I put myself in this opportunity? But then I don't feel lost because I found my support system. I wish that you guys, okay, just can see my, I don't know whether you can see my mouse or not. My support system in terms of, you know, the group of friends, and then we went for kayaking. And then there's a teacher who really educated me, like, what is autism, like how to engage with them. It was this support system really like, give me an opportunity to look at the other perspective. It's not I'm always right, but it gives me an opportunity in terms of to look at the other perspective. And I in India in 6 weeks, and it really takes around 2 weeks to be adept in India. Okay, just because I'm an Indian in Malaysia doesn't mean they speak the same language. I will story you more about this. So I was really hard in terms of communicating with the kids because autism means some kids are not audible, some are audible, some are not audible. Okay, so even though they are something they're able to communicate with you, they don't use the language that I use. They don't even understand English. They don't even understand Tamil. They don't understand even Bahasa. The only communicator I used was my gesture. Okay, like, hey, no, sit. So it was really, really super intense journey. And if you can see the colorful balls, right, there's a kid inside. He is like super, super hyperactive kind of person. On the first day I went, he started to attack me with the balls. Okay, it was super painful. It's not easy to handle, but overall, you know, it really takes my energy, and I was super tired in terms of handling these kids. And then I started to text my friend, hey, I'm super tired, what should I do? I cannot even communicate, I can't even stop him. He's like super energy, like he's not a human being, he's like he's a robot or whatever. So it makes it really fully like taking my, I started to question about my journey, like why do I have to put myself these kind of questions. So I really took time, and then I really put effort in terms of how to communicate with them, how to engage with them. So if you see at the blue sides, right, blue sides is like the reflections that I had to myself. It's not about reflections personally, it's about the thought process that I had to myself, which means the thinking process, which means when I'm engaging, like, you know, I'm like a sport teacher in that school, to be honest. So I was a sport teacher. I just do any exercise they're able to do. We cannot expect they're able to super stretch. Okay, they're like, they have like physical abilities as well, like disabilities. Okay, so I just do something that, you know, they can do as well. And then this girl, this is like a very, very important person to my experience, and I think to my life as well. Okay, she's not a girlfriend or what, but she's from Spain, and she really impacted me in terms of like, you know, like washing away my insecurities. So I communicate with her. Actually, she shared her life to me, like in terms of how she was. It's not easy, like tell your life to a person, okay, like be open up and everything. It's not easy, but I don't know, she trusted me, and then she trusts me things, and then it make me think, if this person that trusts me, why not I'm not trusting this back? So I started to share my insecurities that I had, or how I feel about myself and stuff, right? She should just share me one thing, okay? She just share me one thing, but I won't share now. I would like to share like the words that she said to me at the end of the at the end of my slides, okay? I will tell you some words, okay? I give you words of wisdom. Take this, okay? And from this experience itself, I start to identify my own values. So my own values is about love. I start to identify that, okay, love, compassion, integrity, those kind of values I start to discover about myself. Okay, 6 weeks is a long time that you put into a very uncomfortable situation that you have to be dealing with kids. And then, and these kids, if you can see the blue space, right, this is the most, I miss him so much. I really, it's like a love-hate relationship, you know. I really love him, this person. And then at one time, I really hate him because he's super naughty. He's super like giving a headache person. Like every time I go to my work, he just takes my things and run. He runs more speed than me. And I have to chase him. And the teacher chases him. Like everyone chasing him. And then he throw balls at me. I have to, you know, you look at the colorful balls at the white side, like a lot of crazy, right? How would you expect he throw everything? You have to collect everything and put it back and throw outside somehow. So these kids, he tried, I don't know. And you know, the days goes by, right? I really love these kids. When I leave, right, the day I leave, I never expected this, that he actually cried. So I cannot handle my emotion. So he cried, I cry, he cried again, I cry again. But then I told him like, I cannot tell him bye-bye, you know, like he's a kid. I don't want to hurt that kid. But I just told him that, okay, I'm going for a while. I'm coming back tomorrow. So I feel so guilty by telling this, you know, and I never appear again. People, don't hang people that way. I think I just don't tell to the kids because of, you know, I don't want to hurt him. Like, he's so small. He's so cute. Why would I hurt him? Okay. I think, but sometimes the teacher would call me in terms of FaceTime, like even in Malaysia, even I'm busy, I was like having a short call with him. And then he still remembers me. This is like something I really shocked, you know, like this kid, I only handled him for 6 weeks. He's so together into me. Like, you know, he just like want to talk with me, not daily, but sometimes the teacher will call and just like, you know, having chit chat with the kids. Even he don't talk. We talk like using hand gestures, even in video call. It's super funny, to be honest. So the next slide is like, oh, how my experience after this, you know, So how I am after this experience is more about, I gain my confidence. I started to love myself more. I believe in perspectives. There's no right and no wrong. It's about how you look at things. And then, oh, I'm not stubborn anymore, okay? I'm becoming more into a more gentle, more understanding kind of person. Okay, this is like a super typo. We always do that in presentations, even in classes, right? So forgive me, people. So I started to be, in terms of acting impulsive or reactive, I approach in a way that proactive way in terms of learning things or reacting to things and stuff. So something I really learn is about letting go. So letting go is something, let go is the one I talk, right? The self-love and let go. So this is like the things I really talked to the girl that from Spain, and I learned how to let go things that so that I can be happy, I can be moved forward, because I don't want the gravity of depression or the gravity of anxiety pulling me. So it's just self-torturing. So I let go my, you know, whatever I had in Malaysia, in India. So I feel happy once I come back, to be honest. It's like super good. And I gain my courage and my self-esteem. Cool. So this is what I gain. And I wanted to share like things I impressed about Malaysia. Like, okay, not Malaysia, it's about India. So you guys, like, you know, I told my things like how it impacted me emotionally or whatever it is. So I also have things to share about the things I impressed about India. So if you ask me, Dana, where did you visit most of the time in India? I would say I visit the beach because there's not only beach, they don't only having beach in India, okay? They have a lot of tourist spots, but I choose to go to beach because I just go there and just want to feel relaxed. It's something near as well to the beach. So I went to this station. I don't remember what is this. And then I went for a market. And then the things that impress me is like the difference between what we don't have in Malaysia that have in India. So when it's a long ride, it's like a 16-hour or 18-hour, I went into using bus. They have a sleeper bed, you know, like you can sleep in a bed, like legit sleeping in the bed. And you are sharing bed with a stranger. So my first experience was, oh, I really wish I don't want to sleep to a person next to a person. Like, it's super awkward. So it's not even awkward. I'm like, oh, it's super awkward, you know. Like, but overall, when you ask universe for something like you never get, right, do the people come and sleep to next to me? So actually, with this person, I don't even remember the name, we start to talk, we start to communicate, and then we started to become like, he shared more about the current situation in India, and I also share about what is happening in Malaysia, the beautiful of Malaysia, the youth in Malaysia, etc. of stuff. So the things that impressed me is the bed itself, but the bed itself, I'm sorry. So, oh my god. So next is the auto. The auto drivers there are super professional in terms of three wheels, okay? You can trust them, even though they will ride the auto like they want to rip your soul from the body, but you still can trust them. They're super good in terms of riding this auto. And then I went for a museum. It's like, I don't know, I just don't know, I feel bored, and I went for a museum just to look into stuff, okay? That's just spending my time. And yes, so this is the kids that I've been handled in my 6 weeks journey. So this is Arman, this is okay, this girl is Gita, and this one is Arman, Gita, and Lakshmira. So these kids are actually I don't know, three people that really impacted me in terms of me finding meaning of self-love, me being grateful, like how I am today. So also me being showing compassion and showing love to people. So these are kids, okay? They are not adults. These kids show me the meaning of love. The kids show me meaning of compassion. The kids also showed me the meaning of headache as well, but the headache that I would love to have. Okay, cool. And I told you guys, right, like the words of wisdom that the people shared to me, and I would like to share this message to you all as well. The first thing is, if a child can learn the way we teach, maybe we should teach the way they learn. This is the important message that the teacher told me, like, if people don't follow you the way you teach them the way can follow. So you understand the people, and then you just adjust your whatever you want to talk, you want to teach, the way they can, you know, feeling approached. So, and the girl that told me one thing is that, you know, the one I said that I let go things, she said that you validate you about yourself, loving yourself wholeheartedly, and you accept the way you are is what matters the most. So you don't put your happiness on someone else, or like you want others to validate you or whatever. So it's more about you, yourself, how you accept you, and then how you move forward is what matters in terms of loving about yourself. So this word is still impacting me until now. And I never had those insecurities that I had before, like how many years back, 3 years or 5 years back. Yes, cool. And the last one is I learned from the kids itself. Okay, so love and compassion is what I need, or what you need, to connect with the kids and bonding with them, because the kids' eyes see your care and your love as well. They never care about how you look or how you scary you are. They only can feel your care and how you like approaching to them. So cool. So yeah, I would like to end is this is my story, and I really want to thanks to Isaac and for giving me the opportunity to share my story with you guys. And thank you so much to India for showing me what is love, for showing me what is compassion, and also showing me the meaning of self-love as well. I really want to, this journey, I really appreciate a lot. Thank you so much. This is my sharing. Peace.
Wow, wow, wow. Okay, so let me present my screen first. So yes, so thank you for Dana for the sharing. I really enjoyed to hear his journey and entire 6 week in India. Now you can move to most exciting part for Let's Chat India, which is Q&A session. So do you have any question? please share with us in the chat box right now, or you can open your mic to interact with our speakers. So, yes. So I'll be asking some questions to you guys regarding with the register before. So Jay first. Okay, so Jay, so there's one question from our audience before regarding the Holi festival in India. Can you know what is the reason behind of this festival?
Yes. Hi, I hope you can hear me. So I mean, what people, so I'll be very honest, that people have different perception about Holi as a festival, what actually it is, and what people see outside. So ideally, Holi as a festival is not playing with color. Holi as a festival is about, if I'm not sure if you guys have seen it, but it's a festival where people worship a bonfire, right? So what this festival means is there's a stack of hay where they create that stack, and towards the night, one day before, when they play with colors, basically what they do, they worship. So basically they lit that haystack and they pray in front of that. So what that is basically is they worship that particular haystack, burning haystack, as a symbol for respect for the Hindu gods which are there, and they basically believe that when they, you know, pray and, you know, just put their belongings there and they burn it up, they think that all their sins that they have done and the wrongdoings and the things that, you know, the bothering them in their life just, you know, gets vanished, or, you know, God help them to relieve from that particular difficulties. And in a celebration of that particular feeling, on the next day morning, they play with the colors. You know, they have a party, they play with colors, there's music. And that is basically called Dhuleti. It's not holy. Playing with colors is called Dhuleti. And that is something that, you know, they do out of joy of the worship that they did and the entire relief from their difficulties that they believe they got after doing the worship.
Okay, nice. So if you guys don't know about Holi festival, right, yeah, you just can Google the what's Holi festival. It's very nice and a lot of colorful, they're playing a lot of color over there. Yes, so we're moving to the question about the Zheng Feng asked for Dana. May I know the living cost in India? Did you spend a lot over there?
Ah, thank you so much for Zenfeng. All right, so if you ask about the cost, right, it depends. Okay, first, it depends on how you spend your own money, people. The second thing is, I feel very grateful because the opportunity that I went is actually they give a one free meal for lunch, so I could save my money. And then also, like, if you ask me of Ringgit Malaysia, how was my total expenses in terms of every single thing, right? I would say it's until, okay, like, I can't say a specific range, but I would say 2000 until 2500, like, that is the range that I spent in India. So if you ask me, I spent all my money in food, so what I gain, also I gain fat as well in my India experience. So yeah, all right, thank you so much, Zenfeng.
Can I go next? I have a question for Dana as well.
Yes, can.
Okay, sure. Hi Dana, I'm Juni from UPM. So my question to you is, can I know what is the food that you have been having in India, and how is the environment itself? Because personally, I have friends from India, and they told me that New Delhi is kind of interesting during the night. So I would just love to hear some sharings from you. Yeah, since you have been 42 days at that, right?
Oh, okay. Thank you so much for another question. Cool. Oh my God, what's happening? Cool. So the food. Okay. To be very honest, I'm honest with you guys, right? Okay, I don't shop with the foods I ate, because the foods I already, because we are Malaysian, we have like Indian cultures here, right? So I'm not that shocked with the food that I ate, okay? But there's a but, okay? It's about the feeling that I have. It's like the feeling that gives me, like, in terms of, oh, you know, suddenly the food never been tastier. Once you taste in Malaysia, it becomes tasty in India. So if you ask me the food, right, and then, okay, the food is like, I didn't get shot, okay? It's something that I had in Malaysia. So it's more about the feeling when I'm having the food. It's a different thing. So if you ask about the environment, I would say the environment was really cool. It's cool, not meaning by cold. It's very, what they call, you know, the cool, COOL. And the environment was very colorful. And it's quite humid as well in India. And I'm still grateful, I'm still alive. But overall, it's something, the environment is actually, it's super, the people itself there is actually very nice. Like, I don't know what we're hearing from media, you know, media always talk, showing us as something that we don't know. But when you go experience in India itself, it's all about the feeling, and the people are super nice. The environment, it gives me the feeling that I feel safe. Also, I feel, even though I'm from a different country, like my motherland is in Malaysia, it gives me feeling of secure as well. The environment is super, is super good. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for the Dana sharing, and thank you for Junyi for asking a question. So, got another question as well. So, Harold, I'm Yusha from UPM. What do you think about lifestyle in India and Malaysia? Is there have any difference? I think, can Jay share about the lifestyle in India first, and then come to Dana sharing the difference? Is it okay?
Yeah, sure. If we ask about the lifestyle in India, it's very, very different in very different cities. So I personally come from Ahmedabad as a city. It's on the west side of the country. The city is one of the growing cities in India, but the lifestyle there is quite calm. People are like not in much of a rush. They have like a daily routine. They start work at 10. They like going to cafes a lot. I'm not sure if it's same in Malaysia, but people like to go in cafes a lot. In Ahmedabad, people are mad about food. I mean, the only thing that they do for on weekends is they go out and have different kind of food. And people are really mad about, you know, so everything that you get there is loaded with butter and cheese. That's how people eat. That's what Ahmedabad. And currently, I am staying in Mumbai. That's one of the biggest cities in India. I'm staying here because of my work. Now, this city is completely different. And even I was facing challenges. It felt like I have been on some other country when I came here. Because the country, this city is really, really fast. I mean, this city is highly populated. There are like, I don't know, there's everywhere people. They don't sleep. Probably if you go out at 2 o'clock also at night, you'll see people traveling back from home, back from work. At the same time, right now in Mumbai, the weather is really different. So here people always carry umbrella with them. They don't know when it rains. So, and it's completely uncertain. So these people always have an umbrella, and these people are very work oriented. So you don't really find a lot of people you can talk to. I mean, they are really helpful. They'll help you out if you ask them, but they are not really free and helpful. They are always into their work, which was different from Ahmedabad. So it's very, very different in each and every cities. But in general, people in India are really fond of celebrations. I mean, every month there is one festival at least in some part of the country, and probably the entire country is celebrating that festival just to enjoy. At the same time, people are really fond of different kind of food, different kind of clothes, which they want to try out when they go to different cities. Even for me, I mean, whichever city I go to, I always first go to food and then whatever work that I have in that city. That's more about India.
Okay, cool. Once you talk about food, I'm starting to get hungry already. So can Dana go next?
This is a very interesting question. Okay, it's a very interesting question. So I think India itself, right, if you want to know, okay, first of all, people, we cannot expect things to be flawless or perfect, okay? It's something that we need to adapt in terms of lifestyle. So one thing that I found is very shocking is like, okay, the language, okay, I thought people that speak Tamil, but in the end, they don't speak Tamil. The only, the Tamil community, they are the south side of the India. So I feel the lifestyle of the Indian in Malaysia is quite similar to the Chennai, the south side of India. But I went there, it was a super interesting place, but importantly, I want to talk about Manipal. So Manipal situated somewhere here, somewhere at the west. West is west, okay, somewhere at the west here. Okay, so they speak mostly Tulu or different language from Tamil itself. So I would like to add on the point where Jay said that people eat chapati, butter and cheese. Yes, they eat, but lifestyle over there is quite chill, and the lifestyle over there also like more student. Okay, Manipal is the area that I went, is they are like full of students. So if you went there, if you want like a student vibes, or you want like I'd say Insta famous life, or like Insta famous you want to wanna be, so the lifestyle is over there. If you want more in terms of traditional life, if you want more into, you want to go deep into culture and etc., you want that kind of lifestyle, I would prefer to go into Chennai, because I feel it's amazing that like to speak my own language and feel comfortable with. So yeah, that's all.
Okay, cool. Thank you for the sharing from Dana and Jay also. So, and thank you for the Yusha for the sharing for the question as well. So, you guys got any questions, just don't hesitate, because this session Q&A will be end in 9:35. So, I hope I can see a lot of your questions from your guys' side. So, yeah. And I want to ask about the one question is registered in the feedback form before. So, yeah. Can I know what's motivation you join the volunteering project for Dana?
My motivation, right?
Yeah, motivation to join this volunteering project.
I think the motivation that I joined. Okay, talk about motivation. Okay, I was so random. So Isaac provided me this opportunity to go for India. It was so random, to be honest. Like I say, hey Dana, can you go India and share me your experience after you come back? If you ask about motivation, it's something that I did not plan. Okay. Something that it just like comes to me. So maybe it was my calling from the universe, like, Dana, for you to change enough, you know, to be like a bad person in your life. I think there's no motivation, to be honest. It's just like so unplanned, like Isaac gave me opportunity to go for this. So yeah, sorry, there's no motivation. Sorry, not, yeah, I'm unable to answer this question.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, it's okay. So for Jay, right, can I know that, do you have any, like any Isaac in India, do you have any like methods to ensure the experience of volunteering in India?
Right, yes. So I mean, when, at least when I have been working, since I've been working Isaac, something that has been a really common thing for Isaac to ensure the experience is coming from the kind of brand itself that I was talking about, India as a feeling. Something that we really believe is the feeling that an exchange participant has by doing each and everything. It's not just about when an exchange participant comes to India, it's not just about the work that they're going to do, but also the experience they're going to have in the country. And even I believe I was in contact with Dana as well when he went to a couple of cities after his exchange, Bangalore and Chennai. So I think to ensure on the quality aspect of the experience, we have certain standards that we ensure that we are checking on a regular basis with respect to from the national office to the local office as well. And at the same time, we have we ensure that each and every LC, we have collected data for each and every LC on how the experience is going to look like, and that is continuously tracked. But yeah, I think the most important thing is for each and every location, each and every city to have a certain checklist on what an exchange participant would be doing and would like to do, and which is the most important part of their experience. So tracking that particular checklist becomes a very important part of our job. And I think that's the most I enjoy, to ensure what kind of experience people are having.
Okay, cool. Thank you for the sharing. So from another question for the Dana, right? Do you have faced any difficulty when throughout entire traveling in India, like the peoples around over there, or do you have faced any like language barrier in India? So can I know about that?
Ah, okay. If you ask me about difficulty, I would say one thing is difficulty. Okay, the first difficulty that comes to my mind was an unstable internet connection. But you know, Isaac there has really helped me a lot in terms of getting like a proper internet connections. I think it's like when I ask, it's a service provider problem. So I bought a different service provider. So it was like, I'm having like a bad connection. And then the second difficulties was like the language barrier itself. Like I mentioned earlier, they speak a different language, and all I did was like I suddenly become professional in terms of sign language, and I'm able to, I mean, like the community itself, like able to speak English, like they know basic English. So next difficulty that I face, I think climate is okay, environment is okay, society is okay. Another difficulty is crossing the road. It is super intense than KL itself. Like the cars will never stop at you. Unless I think you are the one going to stop the car never stop at you. They just like go. They just like pass. No one will stop for you. So, and I think one thing I want to add on environment is quite dust. It's quite dusty. Like I would suggest to wear some face mask, because I think because of, you know, cars are traveling and those kind of stuff, right? The dust just flies. So it's just like, it'd be better if we cover ourselves. Yeah, that's all.
Okay, cool. So I think this will be the last question. So a panel from the audience got asked about this, right? How is the COVID-19 situation in India currently? So he's quite curious about that.
Right. Thank you so much for the question. Being very honest, the COVID-19 situation in India is not the best at this particular moment. We as a country, as I mentioned, it's a really, really huge country. We are trying to tackle the problem that is existing. With respect to how the situation is being handled in the country, currently the country for the last 2 months, the country was in lockdown. It just got like a few ease or a few less restrictions have started from the mid of June, and we have been, you know, we are able to like move out of our homes after that. But yeah, with respect to the number of active cases, those have been quite increasing every single day. And overall, as a country, there are like two to three cities which are like majorly affected. Apart from that, the cities, other cities are quite stable. But as a response, the country has been reacting, or the people of the country have been reacting well. They have been using as much precautions as possible. And the regulations as well have forced the people to use all those precautions. And even the workplaces, even where I work, and I was in Ahmedabad at my place. I recently traveled to Mumbai for my work. So even that, the travel inside country has also been quite normal. We can now travel. Things are getting better with respect to the restriction. The situation, the active cases are not the best, being very honest. They are increasing. They are getting a bit higher. But yeah, the response of the country has been going well. There's also been a medicine which has been manufactured for the cure. The medicine recently got a certification, and it's not a vaccine. It's a medication for cure once you contract that particular virus. So that's something that has been done by an Indian medical company, which is now in manufacturing, and that is being circulated. I think that's pretty much of the situation.
Okay, nice. Thanks for sharing. So if you guys got any questions, just type out in the box so that we can proceed to the in the next place. Maybe have a chance to proceed for the question. And yeah, so thank you for that. So we'll be moving, without further ado, we're just moving to the next session. It's a feedback. Just you guys can scan the QR code so that you can take time for filling the QR, filling the feedback form so we can improve in this next move sections. So yeah, I will send the link to here. Chat. I will estimate 2 minutes for you guys for filling. If you guys need a more time for filling in the form, you can tell me about it. Okay, so actually I got some question for Dana as well. So in the meantime, right, so can I know, got any difference you face, like exactly the, you mean, you just now got mentioned the crossing the roads, right? How was the, your crossing the roads, really just like use your hand to stop or any action you take to stop crossing the car to crossing the roads? I'm really curious about this.
Okay, ask this question. I would say trust yourself in terms of crossing the roads. So I don't use hand, they don't respect, okay? In Malaysia, we have like hand language.
Yes,
this hand language is not using in India. It's only using in Malaysia. In India, you have to trust yourself and trust the people beside you. If that's the people beside you, right? Just go near to them. And then when they're walking, just walk together. When they're moving backward, just move backward together. So yeah. This is like an important step you need to know, okay? Just have to trust yourself. When you feel that the car is far, don't assume the car is coming slow. They're coming super fast. Okay?
So can I know, Jay, is it true or not? Or maybe you got another method to like crossing a road, like a different way, a special way, so it can maybe help Dana in future?
Yes. I think something that we as Indians are quite adapted to do. When Dana mentioned that what can you just cross the road, don't wait for the car, that's quite true, because people don't really wait for you. But yeah, usually what happens, at least what Indians do, is just like they'll show the sign to the car. They'll basically show them that I want to cross the road. The cars don't listen to the traffic light sometimes, but they listen to you if you show hand. If you tell them that okay, please let me go, and they'll slow down a bit. But you need to ensure that you are also maintaining a good speed, at least in a proportion with what car is moving with, and you cross that road there.
Okay, cool. So in the meantime, right, maybe you can use for future if you want to go for India. Yeah, and in the meantime, right, maybe Jay can teach us some language. Is very useful when go for India, like hi and thank you something.
Right. With respect to hi and thank you, that is something that most people would understand in India. I mean, they are quite habituated to use a few English words. So hello, hi, thank you. These are things that they'll for sure know. But something that we always use when you want to address someone, we don't really use sir as ma'am as a first thing. So basically, as a replacement for sir, we say bhaiya. A literal transition of bhaiya is brother in English. But to address anyone who is elder than us, or who is someone that you want to address or want to call, we say bhaiya or didi. That's something which is very, very common. There are a lot of languages, so I think the most preferred language would be Hindi. But even like a lot of places in India don't really go well with Hindi. Like if you visit Chennai, the place that Dana was mentioning about, if you go to Chennai and Bangalore, Even Hindi is not something which is really, really famous. It's quite famous when you remain towards the west or the north region of India. That works well there.
So let me recap. Is that called Baya? Is that correct?
Yeah.
Baya. Yeah. Baya.
Yes.
Cool. So, yeah, I think this is the end of this lecture session. Maybe thank you guys for joining our lecture and your feedback as well. So can we having like photo session to like take a good photo? Yeah, if you don't mind, can just open your webcam and then I can take photo for you. Yeah, come just open your webcam. Oh my God. Hold on, I'm not presenting. So, Zhenfeng, maybe can you help me for the set the photo? Okay. So, yeah, and then I will say 3, 2, 1, yay! So yeah, thank you guys for the group photo, and yeah, and thank you everyone for joining for this space as well. So if you guys got any feedback, just fill in, and any question can ask inside the feedback form as well. So thank you, I really appreciate that. And see you guys in the next time in following events. And have a good rest as well. And enjoy your weekend. Thank you.